for the introduction. Thank you for having invited me here to this talk. I will give four lectures on the topic of Genode, the Genode OS framework. That's an operating system technology that I developed together with my colleagues. There will be four lectures. The first lecture will give you an overview of the architecture, the fundamentals of the framework. Afterwards, the second lecture will get you started with the programming environment, so using Genode in practice and introducing important APIs. The third lecture will be about the components and how those components interact with each other and how they can be composed, as well as giving you an overview of the components that are available right now. The fourth lecture then will be focused on advanced scenarios, so I will present you several techniques that are pretty powerful and go well beyond the possibilities that we have with current generation operating systems. So let's start with the first lecture about the Genode architecture. So this lecture will first give you a kind of motivation. Why are we doing this? So why do we need a new operating system? What's the motivation behind it? Then I will tell you how Genode came into the picture, and so the origins of the project. And the main part of the talk will be about the architectural principles of the operating system architecture. And I think it's very important to let this really sink in, because it's fundamentally different from the operating systems that we are using each day. A very important part of this whole picture is the core process. This is the root of the Genode system. I will give you more details on that. And with this, equipped with this information, I hope we have everything in place that that we can apply these mechanisms for a practical kind of example, like the creation of a new process. So how does this work in Genode? And finally, I will finish the talk by giving you a simple example setup that you might also try out yourself when exploring Genode. So why do we need, or why do we desire to have a new operating system? First, there exists a kind of myth or misconceptions about operating systems that are almost universal truths. The first of these myths is that ease of use is somehow contradictory to having a secure system. So there are a lot of practical evidences of this claim. For example, people are repeatedly telling that SE Linux is extremely hard to configure, so the default policy of SE Linux is well beyond 30,000 lines of code, just policy. So it's so hard to capture this kind of information, that, and it's so hard to administer such systems, so that SE Linux had failed to have any inroads in today's major Linux distributions. So people are really discarding this solution, because it's deemed to be really hard to use. And so there's, from the user's perspective, there's always the notion that security is something that makes systems more complicated. And yeah, you possibly know a lot of examples of this thing. The second kind of universal truth is that resource utilization is somehow contradicting resource accountability. So resource utilization, that's what we find in today's operating system. Basically, we have a number of physical resources available, but for example, CPUs or memory or devices, network bandwidth, and so on. And we try to utilize these resources as much as possible. And this comes at the cost of accounting these resources properly. For example, on a Linux system, the kernel tries to pretend there is an unlimited amount of memory and disk bandwidth and network resources. So each process can assume that there are no bugs. So this consequently, a process that consumes a lot of networking bandwidth can harm the performance or the quality of other applications that are using the network. system. So if you take the X window system, for example, 50FY comes up to the X server and asks for a new window. The X server will just provide this window to the client, but will not account the resources that are needed for the window to the client. So any client can come to the X server and request an arbitrary number of windows, and it's not the clients that are paying for this, it's the X server. So here, resource utilization is really taking the front seat, and resource accountability is not even considered. And of course, this leads to a number of problems. I will come to that later. But I'm saying that these kind of myths that resource utilization and resource accountability are contradictory is not inherently true. And the third misconception is that complexity and scalability are somehow contradictory. I will just give you two examples. So if you look at isolation kernels, so that's basically a similar concept as microkernels, but these kernels are even more small, more simple and more rigid. These kernels provide only a static partitioning of the system. So at compile time, you define a set of compartments and assign resources to these compartments. For example, physical memory, stack space, and CPU time, scheduling parameters. And then this kernel is not doing anything at runtime. It's just making sure that these partitions are scheduled, and each partition accesses only the assigned resources. So these kernels are pretty simple in code complexity. So some of these kernels are in the order of 1,000 lines of code. But the price we pay for this for simplicity is that those systems are not scalable at all. They are very static. They cannot be updated. These system parameters cannot be changed at runtime. And so these kind of systems are only found in very small specific application areas, for example, in avionics systems. So, but the security properties or the robustness properties of such systems would, of course, be desirable to have also on other devices, for example, on mobile phones. So, but because the system is too unscalable, mobile phone vendors turn to Unix, to take the Unix kernel and put it on a phone, like the iOS and the Android phones. They are using Unix kernels. And these kernels, they bring in a lot of complexity. So millions of lines of code introducing a lot of attack surface on the devices. But at least these kernels, they bring in the ability to have dynamic workload, to update the system at runtime, to start new applications, stop applications. So all these nice features that we expect from a mobile OS. So the problem with the current situation, with the current mainstream operating system, is threefold, I would say. The first problem is the enormous complexity. If you take any currently used operating system, any application running on top of this operating system has to trust an enormous amount of code that is in a software stack underneath. We are speaking of a trusted computing base. So, taking an example, if we have a security function on Linux, for example, if I sign in, so if we look at a trusted computing base for the signature operations, we have the kernel that sums up to a million lines of code, or even more. Then are the loaded kernel modules that are loaded at at start time, but also the kernel modules that are candidates to be loaded. So basically, some kernel modules are loaded automatically. For example, if a certain network protocol is requested by a user application, the kernel is loading this network. Kernel modules that might be loaded. Secondly, there are all the schemas that are started by the init process, so all the services that are running bit stack of code must be trusted with regard to the confidentiality of my private information. And so basically, it comes out that user credentials are exposed to millions and millions then. So what's the problem about this complexity? So of course, one immediate problem is that the likelihood is really high. So there are statistics of long-running and mature software projects that suggest that if you have code of 1,000 lines, there is one bug in there somewhere. So this statistic was done for a software company that has established a kind of rigid process flow in the company. So if you look at a lot of today's components in the world of Linux, for example, that's not really the case. So we have to assume that the bug rate on our corpus technique that we are using is actually even worse. And these, so if you consider 10 million lines code in your trusted computing case, just looking at the statistics, there are over 1,000 of bugs looking there that might be used to text or may be just to compromise the system. So we have direct attacks, the probability for direct attacks and also non-directed attacks. So for example, a kind of attack that just tries out a lot of security problems that are known in certain kernels and try to impact the developer like something what that will. And then another problem inherent to this big complexity is that there is no way to counter zero day exploits. Like zero day exploits are a big concern for basically it should be a concern for everybody because it really endangers our privacy. And these are bugs that are known only to a few people that have discovered them and probably sold them to a secret agencies or something like that, or criminal organizations. And so but each of the operating systems that we are using today has a number of those exploits that are not publicly known, cannot be fixed until someday they so fix. And so by having access to such a zero-day exploit, all kinds of computers can be equipped with some kind of Trojan horse from the grid. In Germany, we had this political issue last year about the state Trojan. So the agencies in Germany believe that they should be able to infect their citizens' machines with their special malware that observes the citizen and reports to the government or to the police. So this is really a concern, a privacy concern, and there is in today's operating system no answer to those concerns. The second problem with current generation operating systems is the presence of a global namespace shared between all processes in the system. Privileged processes, but also other user processes. So there are a lot of different examples. For example, user IDs, process IDs, or all network interfaces or hardware interfaces have global visible names. They have port numbers or TCP ports. All the device nodes, minor numbers, major numbers, and a lot of more. So all these names are fully visible in the system. And the problem that arises from these names is, of course, they leak information. So, for example, by having the global namespace of PIDs, an attacker that just managed to get user access rights in the system can observe which other users are present in the system or which services are started, or can see if PIDs are changing, so processes are started at runtime, possible patterns in the workload. So this information are basically not needed by any the programs in the system, but they are still exposed. And the second problem is that the name itself is a potential attack vector. So I'll try to explain this. Everyone in the system is using the same notion of names and naming resources. An untrusted process can specify such a name to a privileged process as an argument. in the deterministic as soon as there is pressure on resources. For example, if the memory runs out, the kernel is best to uphold the illusion of unlimited memory by swapping out a memory disk, but the system performance gets orders of magnitude worse compared to our memory access. And so in this case, the system updates indeterministic and cannot be. I would even say that the temperature starts using swaps are suitable because it's 1,000 times slower than without swap. And there are a lot of other things like a graphical bind that consumes a lot of resources of the X server. So all these access patterns need to be somehow captured. And because to provide still a useful experience, the Linux kernel uses a lot of complex heuristics, like IOs get burst and get that are trying to detect patterns of how the processes behave, try to derive certain statements for this bed. But ultimately, if we get short of resources, we are still getting exact. So this is basically what happens when the process consumes too much memory. The system just cannot handle the memory pressure. So the third problem that we observed in today's operating systems are the lack of proper resource management. Or at least not the lack of resource management, but the lack of accountability. So today's operating systems try to optimize for throughput or for resource utilization and pretend the availability of unlimited resources to each process that is running in the system. For example, each process has the illusion that their amount of memory is unlimited, so it can allocate memory as much as it likes, calling M. Or doing just a malloc and using the new operator anyway it likes. And the kernel somehow tries to accommodate those requests. And the ultimate problem here is that in reality, the resources are limited. And at a certain point, the kernel really has a hard time trying to keep up with this illusion. It tries to swap out memory for this to pretend that there is more memory available than there is, but finally, if we really get more pressure on the system, we end up with problems like this. Like this, the error message that appears in the e-messed output of the Linux kernel. Once the memory pressure gets too high, we see a kernel stack dump over here, and see this message like out of memory, build process, sacrifice child. So the only thing Linux can do in this situation is to just kill one process and hope that this process is not does not do any harm too bad for the system. So to minimize the probability for such attacks, there are a lot of heuristics built into the Linux kernel, heuristics to detect the behavior of different processes, use different scheduling policies for them, and heuristics for I/O access and stuff like that. But this all makes the kernel more and more complex. So to solve this kind of problems, there are a number of key technologies available, and we try to use them. First key technology is, of course, microkernels. So you have learned about microkernels in principle in the previous lectures. So I won't need to go into the detail here, but a second key technology is the approach of decomponentization or also called kernelization. So that's the approach to take a huge software stack, a very complex software stack, and identify the few security critical parts of this software stack and try to extract these parts from the big software stack and put it into a different address space. I'll give you an example. If you use a VPN gateway, so you have a TCP/IP stack that also supports important step. The third key technology is scalability-based security. This makes the way free to get rid of global namespace of the system, to give each processing system a local view. And the fourth key technology is virtualization. So virtualization enables us to redesign an operating system, but at the same time retain compatibility to existing applications. So we do not have to cut off all the existing code, we can just reuse it and use virtualization as one piece in our system. So, but given these key technologies, there are a lot of tricky questions to solve. And when we started with Genode, first we asked ourselves how to build a system without global names. So, if people or processes don't know each other or don't know the names of the resources, how could they work together? And so, for example, how can processes in a system interact with each other without knowing each other? Or how can they access resources or pass resources among each other without knowing the parties that are really traits? Even more complicated, once we have handed out a certain resource to somebody who we don't know, how can we make sure can at some point regain those reasons from the alien. So that's it looks like a quite hard problem. Another problem is that contrast to today's system that are used global names, a system without global names, we do not have the way to express policies on a global scale. So we just have one configuration file that specifies the whole policy of the system. So we have to do this in a distributed fashion. So how to express and how to deal with those distributed access control policies. And another point is that we want to still observe the system in some way to see what is going on, what information is exchanged between different processes. So how can we monitor communication in the system? And another problem that really arises for dynamic systems is that once you have a system running and have a certain process running, and you want to change the system, you have to need to kill a process in a system or build a subsystem. And how to do that without just the knowledge of global names, how would kill a certain subsystem? Oh, that's fine. Microkernel-based system is suffering from bad performance. So that's a kind of common knowledge that microkernel-based systems introduce indirectness and thereby tend to what in monolithic systems. So we need to try to address this concern and to avoid those performance problems. And secondly, the architecture, we need to put it into a real implementation. So that's always a challenge. So now let's see our Genode infrastructure. I will give you a brief overview of the history of the work that was done on the OS chair at the Chief Race. When everything started with for doing inter-process communication between processes. So this was when the component transition idea started, really, at the operating systems share, and then a lot of projects came into play. For example, the Linux for reusing Linux device driver as microkernel components, or the Dope GUI server that was adding real-time graphics capabilities to the system as a separate component. We somehow changed the Flink IDE compiler with a more more sophisticated IDE compiler called DICE. We created the Eclipse TCP IP stack. This is basically a port of the Linux TCP IP stack to the microkernel system. And another major step was the introduction of for Linux 1 F4N, which enables now to run multiple sensors of L4 Linux and also really isolate the L4 Linux kernel from these static configurations that was still being used over here. So at this time the research was still dominated by a real-time quality of service. And at this start to change, the Qt aspects become more prevalent. And one big project, or one important project, was the Big Cleaner project, which was about creating a prototype of VPN gateway that using microkernel technology and also facilitated the reuse of the TCP/IP port of Apple Linux. So, another component that related to the security activities is the Nipticker GUI server, which is a secure graphical user interface. And everything that we did at that time culminated in this demo that we released in 2006, which contained all the results that we created through that time. So when we started Genode, this was really our ideal environment. So we wanted to have a secure and reliable operating system. We had the experiences required for doing all these projects, and experiences were taken into account for creating the Genode concept. But what is missing in the picture here is the book. So we are still using Fiasco kernel. There was no Fiasco.OC kernel at the time. There was no Dover kernel at the time. So we had basically an operating system idea about kernel that is really suitable. So when we started the prototype of the system on Linux or Fiasco, we figured that when we managed to accompany with our system run on both these kernels, it should be flexible enough to support other kernels later on. So this was basically an addition out of inspiration that we designed Genode in a kernel-independent way, and the provide all the resources that are needed to run this process. For example, here and course are standard process. Fork provides all the resources needed to start the inner process. In return, Core gets all the robot subsystems. So Core can do whatever it wants with the inner process. Can define the virtual environment of this process in any way what it wants. And it can also provide application interfaces to the subsystem. So that's up to the policy of the parent. The interesting part now is that this protocol between parent and child works recursively functionally. So basically, for use by the user and the application to interact with its parent, it's the same protocol as over here, at the root of the process tree. And this protocol is interesting, and it's very, very simple. It consists of two basic operations. The first operation is the ability for a child process to announce a certain service to a different. So that when a new process starts, also it did start the new process tree, that we have no ways to interact with the outer system. The only thing that the GUI process can do is talk to the parent capability to the parent. So the GUI can just tell the parent it's interacting a certain service, the GUI service. So now at this point, init knows that child provides the service. At the second stage, then the user application might try to use the GUI. So choose a request for the GUI session with the special parameters over here to the parent. So the user application does not know who is really the parent. It just has an entry point to send this message to and hopes that the parent can give it. So it just tells the parent, open, give me a GUI session, and I'm interested in reading user input, and I want the window, the label thing, the string window. So the user session now, as the parent of the application, receives this request and can now take policy decision. So put, for example, just discard the request. It could just drop it. It might conflict with a certain policy. Another option is the user session provides the GUI source help. Put just pass back to a locally implemented version of the GUI source. Another option would be if the user session would know another child process that provides the source, but would delegate the session request to the other child. But here, this picture, you can see such a child. So what the user session is doing here is pass the request down the tree and ask for usage in the name of the user application at the end process. And here, there's an interesting point. By doing this, the user session can modify the construction arguments of the session. So, for example, the user session can impose the policy that the label is indeed not what the user application wants to have, but it specifies the name of the user and also the name of the binary that is really used. So, the user in the session can impose the custom policy on this GUI session this way. So, now the request comes up in the init process. And the init process can again take such a policy decision. In this case, it decides to route the session to the other child, to the GUI child, and again able to modify the policy. So in this case, the init process decides to disallow the user input by the user session. So it can impose this policy again to this, and then the session request is propagated to the GUI. The GUI will then create a new session. This is the bulb over here. And ability to assume that the client one will open a window and a GUI server. So the client can issue a request parent a new GUI session. The GUI session, the parent might ask the GUI session for a new session, and the GUI session would say, oh, thanks for the request, but for accommodating your request, I need a certain amount of memory to store all the pixel values and store the metadata. So I will provide you with this service without getting paid. So I have some resources in order to provide you with service. So the client can attach a certain amount of its own resources to the session when requesting the session by the parent. So the client basically tells the parent, please open a GUI session and transfer 1 megabyte my own big folder to the service. So what the parent is now doing is it's transferring 1 megabyte from the client to the server and passing the request to the server, telling the server, hey, someone wants a new GUI session and I have transferred 1 megabyte of folder for you, provide the service. And then the server can use this information to decide whether or not to create a session. And once it created a session, it can keep track of how many resources it really allocated behind this session. So you have a resource trading system. And the important part is that this is not just looking at just one level, it's looking for arbitrarily complex trees. So if you have a nested tree and client sits somewhere over here, that same problem can be used to trade resources to a server sitting here. Next, the ability with this tree architecture is that a parent in a chain of parents that build a request, a session request, can was the mediate this request. For example, in this case, the client has the sort of this parent might just deny it. Another important aspect is that a parent can also virtualize the access to a resource. For example, here we have the wrong system somewhere providing config file for the system configuration, and somewhere after here we have the client asking and for a config. So the parent can just decide the mandate service is the wrong service locally and hand off the configuration file by virtual configuration file to the client, and the client cannot not see any difference. So the parent can just intercept the request and provide virtual reason. That also happens for all kinds of reasons, not just for files, but also for memory map IO or something that interrupts and all kinds of resources. Another very important relation is that once we have a server that is used by multiple clients, is used code validated by clients, but like the blue client has a session with a certain amount of quota, the red client has a session with this amount of quota, server can now properly use provided a resource to provide the service. But it has to keep track of the different allocation. So if the server allocates memory, it needs to know what allocates memory for the blue or for the red document, or what do I allocate the memory for myself. So the problem here is that the server just allocates memory using malloc or the new operator, all this memory object located would be scattered on the same pages. So would have one memory page that would contain both blue and red objects. So when once the one by one was requests the closing of the session, which tells the parent please close the red session, the parent tells the server please close the red session and release all the red resources, the server had no chance to work. The server can, of course, deconstruct all the small objects that was deep, but it could not free the memory pages used by because there are still some blue objects in there. So the important part is here that the server needs to use distinct heaps for each session. So it partitions the heap of the server into small partitions, use each heap partition for a different session. And once we do this, we can comply with the parent tree to close the session. So when looking at the parent literally on top there's opening and closing sessions, the configured data. Then we have the session request, so the child specifies a name, the arguments to the parent, and the parent retrieves the session capability once the session is established. Then there is an upgrade call. Upgrade call allows the client to upgrade the session quota for a given session. For example, program tries to have the session and later on decides that these bigger windows that the query session might just want to say, no, you only have donated me 1 megabyte of memory, but I would need 2 megabytes to make the window bigger. So the client has the need to upgrade the window. So, and finally, that, of course, that's the request to close the session. So that's it. That's the current thing. It's pretty simple. Another important interface is the so-called interface, the interface used by the parent to work with new instances of sessions. So this interface just takes session arguments and returns the session capability. The upgrade call responds to the upgrade call on the parent interface. So the parent just tells the server, hey, I have upgraded for session quota for the session with this amount of memory. And we have those sessions. So that's the operation. So when looking into more detail, I will think before in detail about only what kind of services are required. We have just a number of services. The log service is just evaluating facility, write output to the kernel console. The run service is used to allocate critical memory objects in the form of data spaces. So you can owner of a run session can call and receive a container with this memory in response. It can of course free this container, this interface. And here these two functions are important for creating a child process. So a parent process creates a new run session. It can it needs a way to transfer a quota in its own run session and the run session of the child. So for each run session, it can define a so-called reference account. So once you set up a reference account for a session, quota can be transferred between reference account and the run session. So this is needed to restrict the transfer of quota toward the branches of the tree and not and to prevent quota transfers across the tree. And here are some functions to request the current state of the RAM quota. The capability service is used under the hood of the Genode framework. It's used to create objects and entities in the system. So this is pretty much kernel dependent how this is implemented. So the core needs to have a bit. But the CPU interface there are to enable the client to create new threads, to create threads. And to start a thread at a given instruction point of second. The IO mem service provides access to the pre-mapped IO pairs. So at session instruction type, the client choose the specifies the base and the size of the MMIO region and also some kind of net flex. In return, it gets the database and the memory mapped IO region. The IO port service similar to the IO mem service, except for that it's referring to the port space of say 6. So the session arguments are the IO port region, and once the session is established, I issue in and out instructions to access the memory mapped IO. The IRQ service is used for attaching or responding to device attacks. So opening a session, the session gets a document IRQ number, and then the client can wait for a new IRQ by calling. So this function blocks to enable IRQ commands. The PDB service is used to create new protection domains in the system and to associate threads with protection domain using client thread call. And at a start type of P that is new created, we also have an ability to assign a current capability to the PDB. So to define which is the initial application point new processes can talk to. The run service is used to provide access to timeout inputs like graph service that is used for hyperspace management. So it is basically used for managing the hyperspace of a process. And the operations look very similar to what we know from F Linux, like mmap and mmap. Using the attach function, it is possible to attach a data space to the to the address space. And optionally, there are a number of arguments that can be specified. For example, how large port blocks can map to only a window of the data space using size set, or you can explicitly specify where the new data space should, what kind of data space should be attached to the database. Then the counterpart of attach, of course, the detach function to remove the, a certain region from the address space, and here it's at line function. To assign the session to a thread to use as a tool for reporting page faults to the given thread. In addition to those functions, there are three more functions that are coming to play when using ARM session, also called managed data spaces. So a managed data space is basically an ARM session that can be used as data space in other ARM sessions. So this is basically a generalized version each table mechanism. And the good thing here is that by installing a fault handler, it's possible to handle faults within this RM session on demand and attach metadata objects in this RM session according to the user of the user. But that's not so important for now. So the signaling is under the better framework. It's not really used by application programs, so I put it in load it to the buffer. Then we can remove the attachment from our local address space again, and we can attach the station, the stable space to the address space of the new group. That's very similar to the partner in this second stage. So now that we have populated the address to new process, we can create a main thread. So for this, we need the CPU connection or the CPU session. We create a new thread within this session and tell which future session to use the address space as result page 4 thread. So next the final step to create a protection domain for the new process, assign the current capability to the protection domain, so that must be provided by the current. And to tell the protection domain that this thread is fitted to the protection domain. Finally, we can start the execution of the thread and invoke the start function to this CPU. So now we specify the entry point as the instruction pointer and set the thread starting to execute. So on the child side, the main thread starting, initializing the struct name, including the exception handling, the execution of local constructors. Afterwards, the startup code requests the process environment, the parent. So there are some call the parent interface to request run session, set, and so on. And finally, all the main function and start doing the interest. So these are the steps required for getting a process running. So I will give you a small example of how this simple magic business can be used to create a simple toy operating system that is used of as a deep demonstration scenario for foot. So this is the scenario. You have a kernel. So I have a little bit blank right now. The kernel we are talking about, because there are several that can be used. On top of this kernel, we have this core component that provides other services that we have just put. The core process starts the process, so that's the only thing for that. Just having one process called in it, assigns all resources in a process, and the process then passes a configuration type. So that's the system configuration passed in it, and starts a copying this configuration file that starts a process is, for example, a timer service that allows buying to for a number of milliseconds. Or you have a certain device driver for the frame form, for example, data driver, here a PS225 driver for user input. Then the init process starts synaptic cookie server. This is basically kind of Windows service. And the launchpad is only a real application. This is a graphical application that using the init cookie service presented in the application. So the configuration file for the init process looks as follows. So I think it's pretty cool that such a system configuration fit in one slide. So I won't go into details of each of the points, but just say that here there is a specification of the parent services provided by the parent of the init process. Then here we define that the information of our session should be routed. So the default output, which is as follows. Init receives a session request by any driver. It looks at the parent writes this service. If this is true, the session request is dedicated to the parent. Otherwise, we look if any the other children are providing the service, and if we find a child, we connect the client with the other child. So that's what this is. Then the remaining part basically consists of those start codes. So nodes express new processes to be started. For example, here we start with the AI driver, assign us a memory code up to the AI driver, and tell it that the AI driver is allowed to provide the AI service. And the same basic pattern can be seen here for all the other processes. We have all these processes providing specific services. And the last entry here is just the application, it writes no service, just gets a of memory, and that's it. So when we use this configuration on a PC, we end up with this kind of a picture on screen. So with, and what I hope to access is device frame buffer is using the MMI tools to accept that frame buffer, and also using several MMIO, Code.io functions to initialize the read of code. The nitpicker, GUI server, is using the typer for regular updates of the in, and also the input driver and the user, and frame buffer over here. And finally, the launchpad is using the nitpicker session to present itself on screen. For the copy, let's say the launch also using timeout to do some nice animations. So, the next I will show you how this tree can be expanded over here. So, we can, the launchpad can be used to create new subsystems. And for this, the launchpad had implemented a built-in policy that looks like follows. If a child asks for permission, the launchpad looks if any of the other children are providing this service. If the service is provided by any of the children of the launchpad, the session request is then delegated to the respective child. But if no child provides the service, the launchpad asks the request down to the parent of the launchpad. So in this picture, we have started the three processes. So that this liquid FTP process that I added here uses a nitpicker session to create a window on screen, and in turn it creates a new service frame buffer for input and announces these services. So it's a virtual version of the frame buffer. So because the liquid FTP provides the same service as used at the full level of the system, we can use the same nitpicker binary, the same GUI server, and start it just on top. And you let nitpicker use the sessions provided by liquid to operate. So this window here, click frame buffer window, you see a second instance of the nitpicker server running. And then the nitpicker service will in turn announce the nitpicker the launchpad. And so the next time we start an application, for example, this scout application over here. The scout application will request the nitpicker session. So the launchpad will delegate this request to this new instance of nitpickers. Your application will just be seen in this window. So if you look at this session picture over here, you see that the liquid frame buffer that we just saw is using the nitpicker GUI service over here, because the launchpad doesn't know any child that provides the nitpicker service. Then later on, we create the new instance of the nitpicker service. So the nitpicker service requests a new frame buffer and input sessions. So these are delegated now to the liquid frame buffer, because now those sessions are available here. And finally, we start a tutorial browser over here, the scout tutorial browser, and this is now using this version of the nitpicker GUI server. So you can see that with a very simple policy, such complex scenarios can be realized. So that's basically what we want to cover today. So I give the motivation of why I believe a new operating system is needed. Then I introduce you to the short brief history of Genode. And in the main part, I introduce the architectural principles, the functional aspects of the core process, the exercise how those bases can be used, create a new process, and or to create a simple setup out of these things. So the next lecture will be about using Genode for programming or for creating new scenarios. So to get started, if you start exploring code base, I will give you a overview of the tree, how it's organized, how the build system works, and how a typical workflow looks like using Genode, or to exacerbate the workflow. And in the second part of the talk, I will introduce you to the various APIs for doing the process communication with Genode, and going step by step through a client server scenario. So that's the talk for the day. And thank you for your patience.